I decided that we were going to go ahead and, for time purposes, since we've had to do so much cramming with your impending vacation.
2 weeks?
That the identical could wait a week. So
we are going to be watching it tomorrow, but that's why it's not going to be on today's video.
Yes. So we're going to start this week with Leprechaun Origins. you told me forever ago that WWE was going to make this movie.
Yep.
And they were going to cast...
Hornswoggle.
Yeah. So I thought that was a little weird and seemed a little straight to DVD, but actually, to be totally honest, I don't know if this is getting a theatrical release or not, but I have seen it now, so I will do you the courtesy of talking about it, I guess. Okay. So we can totally and completely forget the Warwick Davis movies, because just to throw this out there, my history with the movies, I know I saw the four, the one, the original, then the second one, then the one where he went to Vegas, then the one where he was in space. I didn't see the Hood ones, but they're probably in my near future. Because I need some Warwick Davis in my life to wash the taste out of my mouth with this.
Ooh, you just gave me an idea. So, continue.
So, well, get that idea out of your head, whatever it is.
No!
Okay, so we start, and it's made pretty clear, really quickly, that they're going for a straight horror thing. We start, and we're in Ireland, of course. And we see these gigantic stones. And this couple's being chased through the tall grass of Ireland. And we just hear roaring sounds. And then they're pulled into the grass. And we hear them screaming and being killed. And then a slideshow that somebody made on their laptop that they're passing off as credits comes up. And besides, Hornswoggle, I feel weird saying his name. I don't think I've ever said it before now.
I don't believe you have. It does feel weird saying it.
Because I'm not really, you know, into wrestling anymore.
You can call him Dylan if you want.
He and one of the guys from Freddy vs. Jason are the only names I recognized in this movie. He was the guy that was in Thailand, too. The really fucked up Gilliam movie.
Yeah.
And then we're introduced, obviously, to four new characters. You have the fresh-faced young girl who's, like, on her way to college and is a history buff, and her boyfriend, and then the two that are there to basically be models for the gore effects. And they're driving, and they get dropped off. And for some reason, the driver doesn't want to go any farther. It's one of those that says, oh, no, I'm not going in there, and leaves. But of course, you know, there are fresh-faced horror characters, so they're like, nothing could go wrong, and they keep walking. And they're in Ireland, naturally, they end up at some pub. and they're waiting, they're sitting behind them is this big Irish guy. He lost his audition for The Informer back in 1935, so he's here now. and he overhears them talking about... They're basically looking around because, you know, she's... My notes are over here now. basically, she's changed her mind about what college she's going to. Which pisses off her friend. So there's kind of... That's about as much character development as we get. So after we get that tiny little bit of character development and they're in this pub, this guy overhears them. And says he knows where it is that they want to go, so he and his son can drive them there. And he seems like a really friendly fellow, so they're like, you know, okay, sure. So they go out there, and they tell a story. He tells the story about the leprechaun that's been... Huge, major air quotes there when you say leprechaun. And the leprechaun that roams the area and kills people, but it's okay because he doesn't go past the stones. Which actually isn't all that important later, despite how important it sounds. Because you got stupid horror movie characters here.
Of course.
Only four of them, too. This movie really wanted to tone down its budget on, you know... I mean, I know Ireland's basically just grass and pubs, but...
Oh! We just lost some views.
But regardless...
Sorry to our Irish fan base here.
No, it's very, very beautiful grass and hills. So...
Reminds me of Soren.
So anyway... long story short, he takes them out to this cabin. That's right. One of them even acknowledges it. They're going to spend this movie in a cabin in the, well, she says in the woods. It's not in the woods because it's Ireland. They're just out in a field.
Cabin in a field.
Yeah, it sounded less sinister that way. That's why she said in the woods.
Yeah, of course.
And naturally, the guy is shady. He and his son. So what we see him do is he's wearing a gold watch, and he takes it off and he hangs it up outside before he leaves them there at the cabin. And then the sun goes down. Lo and behold, the gold watch obviously is bait to bring forth the leprechaun, which he apparently has a debt to settle with, so he is giving him these human, like a human sacrifice to him.
Mm-hmm.
And the leprechaun, well, I guess, will leave them alone.
Now, sure.
Let's talk about what the leprechaun looks like. Okay? First off, I don't know why they even hired an actor, because this basically could... Number one, they don't really show him a lot.
Yeah, I heard about that.
And when they do, I was confused. Because the first few times we saw him and heard him... I was under the impression that maybe this is just like some minion. Maybe this is some monster that lives in the cave with the leprechaun that he sends out to go kill things for him. But no, this thing is the leprechaun. Okay. He looks like a walking gargoyle. He's got like the hunched over legs, and his face is kind of like, Not exactly like the I Am Legend vampires, but he has no hair, and he's got like slits for eyes, and the rest of his head is basically a deformed mouth with teeth. And he doesn't talk, he just roars and growls. That's what the leprechaun is.
That's not the leprechaun, I don't care what it says.
And... because of this, I was starting to think, okay, maybe I totally misinterpreted this thing. Because I was under the impression that it was supposed to be kind of like a prequel to the Warwick Davis movies. Hmm. Hence the title. It doesn't really, there's not really a specific timeline, but I just kind of came to accept the fact that I had been informed wrong. And this was like some random leprechaun movie that was in no way supposed to be related to the Warwick Davis movies.
It's like Catwoman, basically. Yeah.
So, not even that, just, like, a totally different thing.
Hmm.
Just, like, a totally different movie about a killer leprechaun. Not even remotely related. So I came to accept that fact, and I let it go.
Yeah.
We're gonna come back to this later.
Of course.
So, of course, they do this thing where, after he has basically left, he calls them the Outsiders. He's leaving the Outsiders to be killed by the leprechaun.
Oh, Nash?
I
wish.
Well, it is a WWE movie, I suppose you can never really tell. So yeah, it was about 40 minutes in, and I finally came to terms with the fact, okay, this is not what I was thinking.
Mm.
Now, here's the thing. And first off, let me go into this for a second. The idea to do it as a straight horror movie. I know a lot of people don't like the Leprechaun movies with Warwick Davis, which I can totally understand. but here's the problem, is when you, especially at the first, my memory's really vague on the other three, but when you look at the first one, there were times where it felt like they were trying to do straight horror, but for the most part, I'm pretty sure they were trying to make it like a horror comedy,
yeah,
intentionally stupid thing. When you look at scenes like him killing the guy with the pogo stick, and the fact that he speaks in rhymes, and that he drives a fucking go-kart with a pitchfork tied to it around, I'm pretty sure they knew they were making a stupid movie on purpose and did as such. Because how do you make a serious movie about a killer leprechaun?
Yeah.
It's extremely difficult next to impossible. But this movie plays it totally, totally straight. This movie has, like, no sense of humor whatsoever, and no sense of, like, hey, what we're doing is stupid, let's have some fun. The whole thing is, like, straight horror.
Sounds like a mistake on the subject matter.
Yeah. Which, you know, in the... Okay. Depending on it, that could work. With Leprechaun, I don't know. It might be impossible, but... To give something that's known for, like, its sense of fun and stupidity, and try to make it something really, really straight horror, like a killer leprechaun, you know, you can do that, and it might seem like a good idea. Especially if there's something to really be had in it. Like what they did with Curse of Chucky, after Bride of Chucky was a horror comedy, and Seed of Chucky was practically just a comedy. And they brought Curse of Chucky back and really brought the horror back to it in a really effective way. That's what this movie, I think, maybe was trying to do. Except for the fact that, you know, the original Child's Play was a straight horror movie. And a really effective one at that. Whereas this one started with the... Whatever. the go-karts. But, and Francis and the kid from Don't Tell Mom the Babysitter's Dead. You know, all that. But they play it so serious that it's just, no, there's nothing to really like here. Now should I go ahead? And it's another thing where it's all these characters that just do really stupid things. Like, they build up the whole, he doesn't go past the stones thing. So he kills off one of them. And the girl, you know, the fresh-faced girl has to go all warrior on everybody. So it's like, okay, he doesn't go past the stones. Let's get past the stones and leave and go home. But no, she has to be the one that says, no, we're not going anywhere until we kill it. Which comes out of nowhere, because this was never going to be a character trait for her. They just threw it at her at the last minute because they needed a climax, I guess.
Yeah.
So that's that. Okay. Now... Let's talk about the fact of it not being related to the Warwick Davis movies. Remember, I had totally accepted this fact. No way whatsoever was this related to those movies.
Okay.
This is a little bit spoilery, but you can probably... It doesn't matter. Because watching the movie, you would see this coming anyway. Not what I'm about to say, necessarily, but the ending itself. Naturally, it's gonna come to a time to where she's the last woman standing, and she has to kill the leprechaun. At this point, it is totally in my mind. No relation to the other movies whatsoever. Well, she picks up a machete or a sword or something, and she's getting ready to win the battle with the leprechaun. And right before she takes him out... She says the fuck you Lucky Charms line from the first movie. And I had this huge epiphany. Okay. So this is supposed to be in line with those movies. Number one, why the fuck is it called Origins? Because it's not a prequel. It doesn't set itself up for a sequel. Once she beats it, the movie ends. Mind you, the movie is... an hour and 18 minutes with 12 minutes of credits.
Oh my god.
I mean, there is, like, if you watch the credits all the way through, the camera, like, focuses on a dark place and he, like, jumps out and goes, blah. But I think that's just, like, an extra thing they just threw in there. Kind of like when the Scream, the ghost face flashes over right before the credits go up and Scream.
Mm.
I guess it's supposed to be like that. So, yes. As if this movie wasn't working enough, it wants to continue to not work by being a failed attempt to be part of the Warwick Davis Leprechaun movies. If you want to talk bottom of the barrel, that's pretty low. When you fail to be part of the Warwick Davis Leprechaun movies. You failed in a franchise where a leprechaun went to space and the hood. What the fuck is wrong with you?
It blows my mind that we're talking about a completely different series, it seems like, and then you said that it does correlate to the original somehow. But, number one, when I heard the first casting of Hornswoggle as Leprechaun himself. I thought it was a brilliant idea because it makes perfect sense because he used to do that gimmick. He did a Leprechaun gimmick for a while. Hence what Hornswoggle is, he's a freaking Leprechaun. So it made sense. And then I saw the first picture and I was like, that's not the Leprechaun, it's some creature. And he doesn't talk. The Leprechaun's gimmick is that he speaks in rhyme and everything.
When you saw the picture, did you think somebody had mistakenly labeled it?
Yes! It was like Leprechaun's minion or something. His Dubot, in this case.
Yeah, to be totally honest, I know people think it's stupid, and it really, really is. But I really, really started to miss Warwick Davis in the fucking green hat and the pointy shoes.
It's like a missed opportunity because you take somebody that's already done that gimmick before on television, mind you, and people know him for that gimmick, and you don't let him do that gimmick when it's a Leprechaun.
If Child's Play can come back with Curse of Chucky, this could have too if they had tried. But then it's every horror cliche imaginable too. So that's it's even got the they even go into the basement and there's the book with the foreign language that needs translated.
The Book of the Dead.
And of course you have the one dooming word, and when it translates to Leprechaun, and that's when they'd have the big reveal of what it is. Yeah. So, you know, I mean, they do have some interesting gore effects. There's a spine that gets ripped out.
That's cool.
The one girl wears piercings that are made of gold, so he just, like, starts to rip. He rips one out of her tongue, he rips one off of her ear. But, you know, it's just, no, this was just a bad idea. This movie shouldn't really exist. So, I think that's about as low as you can get as far as a criticism. This movie just shouldn't exist.
Wow.
And speaking of, no, wait, we're not going there yet. Our next movie is another movie that connects with another movie.
Yeah.
Our next movie is Life of Crime, which I got really, really excited for immediately because it was some of the most brilliant casting I had ever heard.
Yes.
Life of Crime is a prequel to Jackie Brown about Ordell and Lewis, who are Samuel Jackson and De Niro and Jackie Brown. In Life of Crime, they are Mos Def and John Hawks. And as soon as I heard that, I was like, oh my god, that is the most perfect thing I have ever heard.
Pretty amazing.
And I knew this was going to happen eventually because when I started to do my research on Jackie Brown years ago and I read Rum Punch, I had realized that Ordell and Lewis were in other Elmer Leonard books. And this one's from one called The Switch, which they'd initially just cracked down to Switch. But then you would have had the problem of having a Jennifer Aniston movie called Switch and another Jennifer Aniston movie called The Switch, which is that movie where Jason Bateman basically commits a crime and gets his semen inside of her. But and an Elmer Leonard Grime movie. So the title Life of Crime is fine. I was really glad when they changed Switch.
It's basic, it works.
Mm-hmm. And it's basically kind of, it's got a lot of Fargo vibes in it. Nice. Not that good, but enough to really remind you of Fargo in a positive way. Mm-hmm. We have, it's worth noting, by the way, with this and a movie we'll be talking about in a couple weeks, apparently Mos Def is going by his real name in movies now.
Really?
That really caught me off guard.
That threw me off completely.
This and Begin Again, he goes by his real name now. So,
you not know Mos Def's shoot name?
The, Yesinbe, I think is how you say it.
Okay.
I'm not sure. But, he's now being called the artist formerly known as Mos Def.
That's what we're calling him from now on videos, so get used to it, folks.
Okay, so anyway, the plot centers around Jennifer Aniston, who is the trophy wife to Tim Robbins. And he basically walks all over her and treats her like shit. And there's a married guy who has his eyes on her that's played by Will Forte. Well, the other side of this story is Ordell and Lewis have this plan to kidnap her for a ransom because Tim Robbins is filthy rich. It's really that simple. But the trouble is Tim Robbins is out in this really fancy hotel having an affair with Isla Fisher. Isla Fisher is playing Melanie, who was Bridget Fonda in Jackie Brown.
That's great casting, too.
And the problem is, he has to... this is like a filthy rich guy who's like going through a massive, massive midlife crisis. So, as far as that's concerned, if this sounds crazy, he's having to choose between Jennifer Aniston and Isla Fisher. The choice for him is very easy. So he just decides he's not going to pay the ransom. And Ordell and Lewis just kind of have to hang on to her while they try to get the money out of him. And hijinks ensue. They're at the house of a Nazi-obsessed weirdo played by Mark Boone Jr., who's really great in this, by the way. he's this really oddball character who is out of his mind, and basically he's basically Norman Bates. All through his house he has holes in the walls that he spies. He can basically spy on her. He has a tiny little picture over the bathroom door, and when he takes it off, in the bathroom door he has drilled a hole so he can watch her. and she eventually gets revenge by throwing a cigarette through it when she knows he's looking through. he basically kind of turns into the villain of the movie. Kind of. This is one of those movies where there's kind of, you know, unsavory characters everywhere, all the way up to the Tim Robbins character, in a different way. And then there's kind of a side plot that comes in a little late where, she kind of starts to have Stockholm Syndrome with Lewis. Well, obviously we know because of Jackie Brown, eventually Melanie ends up with Ordell.
Mm-hmm.
So that kind of starts to come into play towards the end also. I thought it helped a lot that they weren't building it up too much. That obviously this movie happens before Jackie Brown does.
Because
any other movie that didn't really have anything else to work with would probably just like feed off of that. And that's it. Just be like making constant references to Jackie Brown. But, and I listened for it because her name is Jackie Burke in the novels. And she's white. So I was kind of trying to look for or listen for that character, but it never really... Unless I really missed it, that never happened. So it's not feeding off the fact that it's a prequel to Jackie Brown. It's just its own thing that just happens to have these characters in it that slowly but surely start to become the characters that we eventually know them as from that movie. Which I thought was a good way to do it.
Yeah.
Now, not just from the fact that they are... I should probably give them more credit here than I am. It's not just that Mos Def and John Hawks are perfectly cast, but they're really good in it too, obviously. Mos Def is perfect, and what's really great that they do, because they've shown before that they're really talented as actors. Mos Def is obviously really underrated as an actor.
Oh yeah.
And, you know, John Hawks is just really taken off now, so everybody knows he's great. The next thing you want to make sure you don't do is have them basically doing impressions of Samuel Jackson and De Niro. Which I think they're experienced enough to where that was never going to be a problem. They weren't going to do that. They would make sure they were doing the same characters, but in their own way.
Yeah.
And you can tell that they are, but at the same time, you can still see, like, even in Mos Def's voice, you can still kind of hear Samuel Jackson. And with, just like some of John Hawks' facial, it's not like the overly obvious De Niro impression, but just in some of his gestures and his mannerisms, you can tell he's doing that same De Niro character without overdoing it. Melanie is almost totally different in this movie, but you can still kind of see the transition she'd eventually make from being the, I guess because of who she is, she's kind of a different character, because with the Tim Robbins character, she's kind of able to basically take control of his mind and make him do things whether he wants to or not. But then when she gets involved with Ordell, he kind of is the one walking all over her. Like the, Jackson's line in Jackie Brown, "Don't make me put my foot in your ass," when she won't answer the phone. but yeah, it's actually just one of those really... you know, fun Elmore Leonard caper movies. It's not like, you know, something great like Jackie Brown or Out of Sight or anything. And it's probably going to be pretty forgettable. But, like, if you just Like, if you, like, have nothing else and you, like, come across it, I think you could get a lot of enjoyment out of it. So, it's funny. They, the really great thing about the Mark Boone Jr. Character is how unpredictable he is. Because they take that in a couple of directions I wasn't quite expecting. I love that they took the, Jennifer Aniston is really good in it, too, because she's basically, yeah, for the first half of the movie, she basically just has to do the trophy wife thing, and then end up playing, Jean Lundegaard, more or less. But they make her really smart, and really, like, prone to fighting back. Like I said, when she puts the cigarette through the hole. She's the one, they put this, basically the way of hiding their identities is they put a ski mask on her that has duct tape over the eyes. And she will just, you know, not even fearing for her life at all, will just take the duct tape off and look at them and say, what are you going to do about it now? Because she's pretty much, she's a smart enough character where she pretty much is under the impression that they're probably not going to actually kill her. And of course the dynamic is great between Ordell and Lewis, because there's that moment where it's really interesting to watch this movie and basically watch it as a fun, funny caper movie. When you know by the end of Jackie Brown, Ordell kills Lewis. So that's another brilliant thing they did here, where you can kind of sense a mistrust between the two of them, even though they're partners, and work really well together. But, and Mos Def has some really great lines, like, well, no, they both do. There's one where they're talking about Mark Green Jr.'s character, and they're basically saying, you know, we're going to tell him it's this one thing, but we're actually doing this other thing. And he has this perfect delivery of, he's so dumb, it's adorable. And then there's this scene I thought was really funny where Will Forte's playing a guy named Marshall. And he's downstairs while the kidnapping's taking place upstairs. And he's coming upstairs with martinis to basically try to seduce her while he thinks nobody's home. And he walks in, and Aniston hears his voice and says, Marshall! And then Ordell knocks him out. And then he looks down and says, who the fuck is this? And then Lewis looks at her and then looks at him and then says, Marshall, apparently.
Nice.
So yeah, it's filled with stuff like that. And as I haven't talked about him really, but Tim Robbins and Isla Fisher do really great stuff too. And like I said, it's just one of those fun, small crime movies that's, you know, good for what it's worth, and you'll enjoy watching it, and I do recommend it, but it's not gonna be, it's not anything, you know, great or fantastic, and it's probably gonna float out of your mind sooner rather than later. Which is still good, because as much as I love this movie, because of the casting, I was kind of preparing myself to be let down. Because I kind of figured it would be a relatively low-key movie overall. Because it doesn't have, like, a big-name director or anything. But, yeah, it did just fine for itself. It's not disappointing or anything. I'd say this is probably about what I expected. Which is a good thing, so. Alright. Oh, man, we're going to do two bad ones right here in a row. Are you ready?
Sure.
Oh, I'm sure you are. Okay. Next, let's talk about Are You Here? Which is really confusing, because this movie was a TIFF last year with Life of Crime. And it was called You Are Here.
Like you see on the map?
Like, yeah.
You Are Here.
Yes.
Okay.
They decided to change it to Are You Here? No, they didn't even put a question mark with it. They just switched U and R. That's all they did. And apparently this took forever to get picked up. and I can understand why. The guy that wrote and directed it is a guy that's like, I think he's a huge in the TV industry. I think he like created Mad Men or something. And a couple of other big shows. And this movie is about Owen Wilson and Zach Galifianakis. Which tells you something. Because you would think, if the movie was, you know, even, I mean, I know really, 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 really bad movies get released wide, but
yes.
there's got to be something wrong with the movie if it stars Owen Wilson and Zach Galifianakis and has the tiniest of releases. Amy Poehler is in it, too. So, there are these two best friends. We're supposed to buy that, but they're really not. And Owen Wilson plays that guy who is, you know, the late... I don't know how he keeps getting this part, but he's playing the ladies' man. Where he basically can get every... Not Leon Phelps.
I was getting ready to say, he can get someone a fish sandwich.
He sleeps with a different girl every single night. And he's practically addicted to it. He's like a comedic version of Fassbender and Shame.
I was getting ready to make that connection, actually.
Luckily, he's always wearing clothes and doesn't, you know, jerk off on camera, so at least we're good there. At least we're good there. But no, his character basically is really perverse, but we'll get to that later. The other character in this movie is Galifianakis, who basically has himself secluded in a trailer where he gets high all the time, and he's disgusting. He's the kind of guy where he has... He didn't even really have a bathroom. He has, like, an indoor outhouse that he keeps the door open when Owen Wilson's just hanging out there. Just being the gross fat guy. That's just what his role is. That's it. And wouldn't you know it, he has a really, really rich dad who has just died. And the movie turns into Mr. Deeds, more or less. Galifianakis' character inherits the whole thing. I think it's like, you know, $2 million or something. And Amy Poehler plays the sister who really wants it but doesn't get it. And then he had a really, really young wife who's like in her 20s that Amy Poehler sees as the evil stepmother that was just gold digging. And that's about it. It's being advertised apparently as a road trip movie. But it's really just one of those movies where they say, all right, Owen Wilson says, all right, well, if we've got to get the money, then we've got to go down there. So they just drive down there, and that's the road trip. It takes like 5 minutes to get through the road trip stuff. And they're just there. So
that's pointless.
And then it just turns into, now here's the thing, okay. This is when the movie messed up from the word action for the first scene, but.
Yep.
When the movie really, really, really goes off the deep end is, for the most part, it turns into a, oh, look how wacky these characters are. Watch them stumble around and run through fields with their shirts off and all that. Hey, Galifianakis' ass crack, that's hilarious. Hey, him using the bathroom with the door open, that's fucking hysterical. Owen Wilson chasing chickens around because he's never been on a farm before.
Son-in-law did that better.
Yeah, that was a turkey.
I'm talking about on a farm.
Yeah. The whole movie could have been that. I don't know whether to be thankful or not that it wasn't.
I like son-in-law.
No, son-in-law's fine. It's just... Anyway.
No point.
Now, anyway, this is when the movie goes off the deep end. All that stuff I just mentioned about it being, you know, this ooh, wacky comedy. About halfway, I mean, they kind of hint through it throughout, but then basically the entire second half turns into this huge moral dilemma drama. Okay. Half an hour ago, I saw Galifianakis' ass, and now you want me to, like, feel like I'm watching a fucking drama. and it takes itself so goddamn serious. Like, really, really seriously. The very last shot of this movie is like... It's like the end of a fucking Thor movie or something. And now, here's the thing. Let's start with Owen Wilson's character, because this is really where the movie falls apart, is with this character. Yeah, believe it or not, it's not necessarily the Galifianakis character that makes the movie fall apart, it's the Owen Wilson character, go figure. I really thought that'd be the other way around.
Yeah.
To be honest. Owen Wilson's character is kind of our protagonist. That's one of the main problems, is I can't really tell. Because he's an extremely, extremely unlikable character that we should be rooting against. But the movie never really plays him off as such. You know?
Hmm.
Like, when a character's really, really unlikable or just really bad news, and the movie knows it, the movie will kind of give him, like, a redemption or a comeuppance or both. He doesn't really have either. I think we're just supposed to accept that this guy is a piece of shit, and that he's been our protagonist for 2 hours, and we're supposed to accept that for what it is. Let me tell you a couple of big things about that. Number one, there is... Actually, no. I'll start with the other one. The big thing here is that he wants to bang the stepmother. So that's basically his plan through the whole movie. But he already has... Okay, here's the problem. He wants to bang the stepmother, but what the movie tells us is that he's falling in love with her. Okay? They've known each other for, like, 2 days, and they really know nothing about each other. We're supposed to think he's, like, cool and hip when he's really, you know, an unlikable character, and I think we're supposed to think she's, like, an evil stepmother when she's actually fine. So this is never going to work, basically. So, this is what the whole movie is. Even though he's, I think he's a weatherman. He works for the news in some way. And he just bangs his coworkers left and right. It just doesn't matter at all. But then he meets this one girl, the stepmother, and it's basically a, this is my new goal. I have to bang this person before I leave and go back home. But the movie's trying to build it up like he's falling in love with her, and they make it really like that. So something extremely reprehensible happens towards the end of this movie. Something just really, really, that just rubbed me the wrong way, and is just really ugly and dirty. but the movie, once again, does not treat it that way. It just plays it off as, oh, this happened in the plot, plot turn, and then they move on. But it's just really, really uncomfortable. And this causes, now with context clues, you could probably figure out what that is. So now we have a conflict between the two main characters. And we've been building up the whole movie now that this stepmother character is going to be the one that makes Owen Wilson change his ways. He's not going to do the womanizing thing anymore. He's going to just be a one-woman person with this girl, as long as she lets him bang him. Her. So, that's what it is. And he gets so angry. Our protagonist doesn't get a chance to, like, no, he basically says that. It's not that he basically lost a chance with the girl he was falling in love with. He lost a chance with the girl he was trying to bang. That's what he is so angry about. And this never turns into something positive. When the movie ends, his character is still in that state. Now, mind you, here's the other thing that's really unsavory about him. Right in the middle of the movie, we're supposed to feel like he's falling in love with the stepmother. And we're supposed to buy it as, like, a legitimate love interest. Well, there's a subplot in the middle of this movie where Owen Wilson's character, in his womanizing ways, is looking out through his window and across the street. Every single night at the exact same time, he has a very attractive female neighbor who strips naked as she walks through her apartment. Trouble is just as she's about to go the distance, there's a tree that blocks the window. And it cock-blocks him every time. So there's an entire subplot devoted to him going to the city to get that tree cut down so he can watch his neighbor strip. While we're supposed to be buying that he's falling for the stepmother character. This is how fucking sleazy this movie is. Like I said, it just wants us to brush it off as, you know, these characters are funny. This is what it wants to be. So, yes, we're looking at, like, you know, bottom of the barrel material of the year. There's a scene I found especially offensive where they go to Outback. Number one, it's not enough that they, I hope they don't, like, accuse us of advertising or, like, copyright shit here, but I'm basically about to do an Outback commercial.
Let's get paid for that, sir.
Now, here's the thing. They've got the real Outback in me. I was thinking back to World's Greatest Dad. Mm. When, as much as I love World's Greatest Dad, this scene really bothers me. It's when he, Alexi Gilmore, and Daryl Savar are going to go out to dinner at Outback. The he being Robin Williams, of course.
Yeah.
And that's what they keep saying. They're going to go to Outback. And when we actually see them at the restaurant in the movie, it's some, like, really small diner with nobody in it. That looks nothing like Outback. But no, the real Outback is in this movie. The logo, inside the restaurant, the wooden booths, everything. And Galvanax's character is a vegetarian.
Yeah.
So naturally, he orders the Bloomin' Onion.
Mm-hmm.
And this whole scene is devoted to Owen Wilson making fun of him for being a vegetarian and bashing the Bloomin' Onion. You get your Outback product placement. You go out of your way to get the real Outback in this movie. And you bash the very best thing that is on their menu. And Galifianakis just sits there and takes it. I felt like Galifianakis was like the Outback company itself, just sitting there taking a beating while Owen Wilson bashed the greatest thing about it. I wonder how they felt about that. Because pretty much nothing positive came out of it for them. Because all he was doing was bashing
it. Yeah.
So, I don't know how Bobcat Goldthwait couldn't get it for World's Greatest Dad. And the movie that's going to bash it, gets it. That's just something that bothered me. It's not like a major criticism or anything. But I just wanted to throw that out there. just another reason to fucking hate this movie. They bash the Bloomin' Onion of all things. You just don't fucking do that.
I'm not a fan, but I don't like onions, so that's me.
Well, then, you shut the fuck up.
You tell me about Big Red Gum now.
Yes.
We'll talk more about Will Ferrell.
So, that's basically what that is. There's a couple of other recognizable faces. Jenna Fischer shows up as a last-minute love interest. So many love interests in this movie, go figure. Peter Bogdanovich has a cameo as a judge. And, oh my god, if you want to talk about really, really wishing I was watching better movies, their lawyer in this movie is also Eduardo Saverin's lawyer in The Social Network. Good god, how I wished I could have switched movies right then and there. But sadly, that is not the case, so... But now that I've reviewed this movie, I pretty much never have to... Well, I might have to talk about it again later this year. I don't have to watch it again. That's the important thing.
That's a good sign.
That's the one little piece of information that's going to get me through the fact that I actually watched it. Okay. Alright. Okay. Maybe, possibly, there's a movie... Well, no, this isn't worse than Are You Here, but... Jesus Christ.
Oh, wow.
Our next movie is called Jamie Marks is Dead. If you haven't heard of it, I think it went to Sundance this year. And got more or less a negative reaction. And I'll just tell you now, I'm really not sure how it ended up at Sundance. And by the time I tell you all this, you'll probably wonder, too. Okay. To give it credit, it does have an interesting premise. It took me a few minutes to figure it out, but once I figured out what the fuck was going on, it was not a bad premise. We have the girl from Homeland, who I know the fan base loves and adores so much, and she's just walking around by like a little creek or in the woods or whatever, and it's foggy and it's in the evening and... or early morning, or whatever. Everything's drizzled with dew, and there's just a really dreary vibe to it. And right there in the middle of the woods is the dead body of Jamie Marks, who was this kid who was bullied at school that nobody really even knew. And all he's wearing are his glasses and his underwear, and it looks like something horrible happened, but... nobody knows what happened, and we pretty much don't by the end of the movie either. Even though it sets it up as... we are. That's the whole point of the movie, but, you know, whatever. This movie says fuck you a lot. So, but she's not our main character, even though she finds the body. At this point in time, I thought we were basically going to have, like, a harmless ripoff of River's Edge. At least. We could have, you know, hoped for something like that. We could have hoped for a ripoff of River's Edge. but no, it's not that kind of movie. And the girl's not even our main character. Our main character is... You don't know this yet because the video hasn't come out yet, but I've already reviewed it. The fucking kid from Mall.
Oh, man.
Who in a couple of weeks you will learn how much I love so much.
September 19th, folks. Keep it on your calendar.
Yes. So, anyway, that kid is the star. And he kind of bullied Jamie Marks when he was alive. So now in death, it's kind of one of those movies where it kind of somewhat touches on the sad, speaking of World's Greatest Dad.
Yeah.
Kind of, but not really touches on that satire of really blowing somebody's greatness out of proportion in death. You know, you have the kids on the news saying, you know, like, oh my god, we never knew Jamie, or like, oh my god, I was like Jamie's best friend, stuff like that. They could have gone a lot more into that, but number one, I suppose it's kind of played out now with Heathers and World's Greatest Dad and a few other movies. But it would have been better than this. But no, the actual concept I was talking about, that's not necessarily a bad concept, they just could have handled it better. Done a lot of things better. Let's talk about one of the funniest movie scenes you will ever see this year. It's actually kind of a couple of funny scenes in one. It's this great jackpot of badness that propels us into what basically the concept of the movie is. This kid and the girl from Homeland just kind of have this bond now, where they just kind of sit around and talk about Jamie Marks, even though nobody fucking knew him. Because I guess they feel guilty, or they wish they had known him better, something. And eventually this turns into a romance? If that's romance, keep it away from me. And they're both just really weird people, and just those. This movie is filled with obnoxious teenager characters. The guy with the hair in his face, the leather jacket, and the loud black car is in this movie. He's the main character's brother. This movie is just filled, all of the characters in this movie are those really obnoxious, pissed off teenagers. Mm. That's what you have to look forward to. So, they're having an obnoxious, pissed off teenager romance. And what happens here is, just let me tell you about this thing. I did some research, I posted about it on the internet actually, and I got a couple of responses. One of them was somebody who was actually at Sundance.
Hmm.
And they said, when they saw this in a theater full of people, the biggest reaction in the movie was people laughing at this. And it's not supposed to be funny.
That's not good.
They start to kiss. Okay, well, no, they're just talking. They're talking about Jamie Marks. And then she says, oh, God, I don't want to talk about Jamie Marks anymore. And then she climbs on top of him. And she dry humps him for about 5 seconds, and then gets off of him, and then they go back to talking about Jamie Marks.
What?
The dry hump is never talked about. Nobody ever says, you know, that happened. I actually wondered if I had imagined it, because it only lasted for 5 seconds, and none of the characters ever talked about it again.
Why would you imagine it?
And they just went right back to the conversation they were having when it started. Like, when she said, oh my god, I don't want to talk about Jamie Marks, and then dry humps him, the first thing she does when she climbs off of him is start fucking talking about Jamie Marks again.
Of course.
And then she looks out her window, and she just stands there like she's in horror. And then she walks away. And then he's like, what did you see? And then she just starts talking, trying to distract him. And he goes to see what she was looking at. And it's Jamie Marks. Jamie Marks is standing there in the woods.
Okay.
As he was when he was found. The pale skin, the underwear, the glasses. Like, wrapped up like he's cold. It is the ghost of Jamie Marks just standing in the woods staring at the house. And she plays this off like it's normal. What? And the thing is apparently if you feel enough guilt about somebody's death, you can see and contact their ghost, and the ghost will follow you around. It's what's happened to both of them. But, and she has the line, what was the line? She's screaming at him to stop thinking about it. Because she says, I don't want a dead boy lurking outside of my house. That's the exact line. Because apparently what you can do that she does that he doesn't, because he feels guilty for bullying him, is, she basically says that if you, she's watched Trainspotting too many times, she says if you choose life, and you just don't think about it, you won't see them, and they'll go away. Mm-hmm. But like I said, he feels guilt, and he feels a fascination towards Jamie now. So he's gonna basically hang out with him. And then, it basically turns into a really, really friendly version of Hellraiser. He just goes there in his house and just hangs out with the ghost. And they just talk. What? So, and he basically gets to know Jamie through this. By the way, I'm wondering if they made Jamie look exactly like Harry Potter on purpose. Because I looked up the actor and he doesn't look like that. They just decided that Jamie Marks should look like Harry Potter.
What?
Google it. So, now, that's the concept of the movie. And this is one of those movies where, well, obviously the milestone of bad scenes in the movie is the dry humping, followed immediately by, I don't want a dead boy lurking outside my house, thank you very much. But there are so many other bad scenes in this movie. He's right there. He's got his head turned, but you can already tell.
Yeah.
See, if I didn't know, I would think that was Daniel Radcliffe from The Saw.
Yeah.
So anyway, now, there are so many bad scenes in this movie. It just keeps topping itself. It never tops the dry humping scene, but I mean, the scenes that follow it just keep topping themselves in their badness.
Mm-hmm.
They have this little thing where Jamie can... I never got this. But Jamie, like, takes words from him. Like, he'll get really close. Sorrow is the one I remember. Sorrow is the word they're using now. So he goes up to Jamie and he says, sorrow. And Jamie says, no. Say it like you mean it. And the kid gets right up into his ear and says, sorrow. And Jamie, like, shudders.
What?
I don't know. Fucking no. It's still a mystery to me. I don't know what the fuck those scenes were. They did it another time, but I forget what the word was. But that's just what they do. Like it's, he calls it, like, taking words or something.
Okay.
I don't know. Maybe they fuel him or something, or make him feel human again or something. There's a subplot with Liv Tyler and Judy Greer. Which is probably the closest you're going to get to anything worthwhile in this movie. But even though they don't really do anything, it's just another reason to make him a pissed off teenager. He and Liv Tyler seem to have this close relationship. She's playing his mom. And then she goes out, and she's backing out of the driveway. And Judy Greer comes barreling at her with a truck and smashes into her and paralyzes her. Which causes them to become best friends.
What?
Well, it's the guilt, I think. Because Judy Greer was, like, kind of a somewhat not really friend. But then she kind of felt guilty after the accident, so she started to take care of her, and then they became best friends, and they're, like, always hanging around at the house together. And which pisses the kid off, because he's like, you know, no, you paralyzed my mom. You go away, you bitch. And then for the entire rest of the movie, he calls her the Paralyzer. and that doesn't even really go anywhere. That's just kind of a little thing that's happening. that just happens to be in the movie. Now, the thing here is, when it starts to get worse, is there's a nice embarrassing scene where we start to meet other ghosts. But there's mainly this other one named... Frances, I think was her name? It's this girl ghost that Jamie, I guess, has become friends with in the afterlife or whatever. And her, as a ghost, she basically does what she does when she died. She stays in her house, and she murders her parents and then herself every single day, like a routine. And then this girl meets our main character. She's basically Moaning Myrtle with a knife. if you can kind of come to terms with that. You know, since, you know, Jamie Marks looks like fucking Harry Potter, why not? And these scenes just get more and more embarrassing. Now, I knew what I was going with that. Another great line in this movie. She doesn't like Jamie Marks very much. The ghost Jamie Marks that she has come to know. Because I don't think they knew each other in life. and she likes to basically make fun of him and throw gay slurs at him. Even though we don't really think he was gay. It never really goes into that. She does the thing where Jamie's explaining what's going on, because we hear her parents screaming. And then she comes out and she stabs herself like she does every night, because she's a ghost, reliving that night every night. And she sees that the main character and Jamie have been watching this happen. So she stalks over with this blood stain on her and says, "Did you enjoy the show, bitch boy?"
That's funny.
Oh my god. So, long story short, this might possibly be one of the worst scripts ever written. It's based on a novel. I'm wondering if the novel was this bad, or if it was something kind of lost in translation. I don't know. I had the same question about Maul, so I don't know. Okay, here's the thing, though. I can't come to terms with saying that it's one of the worst movies of the year, because it really does have something going for it. Number one, the movie's comedy gold. It's this horror drama thing, but it's honestly one of the funniest things you will see for a long time. in the worst ways. You got this kid who's trying to basically top Brent Waits for the worst performance of the year. he and the girl from Homeland are trying to beat Cara Gillan and Brent Waits for worst performance of the year. So, from their wonderful work in Oculus. and he, with him doing Maul now, he and Brent Waits are battling for worst performer of the year. So... don't forget, this guy was also in The Giver. We never mentioned that. So yeah, this guy did this, The Giver, and Maul all in the same year.
Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah. So, can't wait to see what's... No, he's doing some Amityville movie next.
I know what you're talking about. We actually have a trailer for it now.
He's in that movie.
Great.
So, yes, awesome. He's getting some practice here with this Moaning Myrtle storyline. So yes, now, I can't say that the movie is one of the worst of the year, because it's got something really going for it that most bad movies don't. Like Are You Here, for instance. The movie is so bad. There are movies that are so bad that they're just, you know... Like, you know, there's the so bad it's good, this isn't so bad it's good, it's so bad it's fucking dreadful. But I mean, those movies where when they get so bad after a while, they're just boring.
Mm.
This movie's badness is mesmerizing. I could not wait for the next scene to see how bad it was going, how much it was going to top itself, and how fucking awful it was. And it never really disappointed. It just gets really, really, it just gets dumber and worse as it goes. And just when you think it cannot get worse, the very next scene will preview otherwise. And it's glorious. I seriously could not wait for the next scenes to happen. I wanted to see just how bad it was going to be. So, I just can't bring myself to hate it that much, if that makes any sense. So, it's probably one of the worst things I've ever seen. It's gotta be one of the worst scripts ever written. It really, really has to be. I almost want to track down this book just out of curiosity. It's got another title, but I forget what it is. Something sorrow. We might find out why the word sorrow makes Jamie Marks orgasm after death. So, yes. Absolutely dreadful, but a comedic masterpiece. Okay. So, our next movie isn't as fun. Our next movie is called The Longest Week. It's actually got a limited release this week. It's one of the movies that's not late, actually. It stars Jason Bateman and Olivia Wilde. And Billy Crudup. So, Jenny Slate's in there, too. And she's got her name on the poster, but she's really not in it very much. Thankfully.
That's a good thing.
We start with, well, first off, I was like, what is this? So I went and looked on IMDb, and I saw that Jason Bateman was playing a character named Valmont. And my first thought was, oh my god, do not tell me they made a comedy Dangerous Liaisons, because that would be beautiful. No, that's just his name, it has nothing to do with Dangerous Liaisons, sadly. Somebody needs to make a comedy version of Dangerous Liaisons, though. we've had the modern version with Cruel Intentions, and we had the foreign version. I forget where it came from. I want to say it was Chinese, but I'm not positive. We have to have a comedy version.
True.
No, Bateman plays basically a man-child whose parents own, I guess, either a big hotel or a chain of hotels. Regardless, they're filthy rich, and he was born with a, no pun intended because we're talking about Jason Bateman, silver spoon in his mouth. Well, eventually, he is now, like, 35, I think they say he is.
Yeah.
And they cut him off. They cut him off from all the funds, and he's gonna have to live life on his own. So he goes to live with his friend, Billy Crudup.
Why not?
Who's also kind of his rival, more or less, but it's more or less a friendship. It's kind of a, it's more like a they know each other well, but they're not exactly friendly towards each other. And they help each other out, but that's about it. So, and naturally, here's the problem. This is where the plot is. Jason Bateman's character is pretty much obsessed with sex, which is really difficult to do when your movie is only PG-13.
Yeah.
So what happens here is Bateman is sitting on the subway, and he looks across from him, and there is Olivia Wilde. Now, if I was sitting on the subway and I looked up and Olivia Wilde was there, I'd probably have the same reaction.
Mm.
Oh my god, this is wonderful. I must, you know, fuck you, Jason Sudeikis. This is mine now. So Bateman gets it in his head, you know, I must have this. And he's the kind of character that has spent his whole life getting this when he wants it. So he basically gets a number out of her. And they become friendly in more ways than one. Plot twist, this also happens to be the crush that Billy Crudup's character has been talking about since we met him. So there's an issue. So, we have to have the not-telling-somebody plot. Will he or will he not tell Billy Crudup that the girl he's been seeing and banging is Olivia Wilde, the crush he's been having for a long time? Despite the fact that he has an on-and-off thing with Jenny Slate, so I can't really sympathize with Crudup here.
Nope.
But the thing is, you can't sympathize with anybody in this movie, because this is one of those movies where pretty much everybody is a worthless piece of shit that you will are impossible to like. First problem with this movie, it's trying to be Woody Allen. It's trying to be many, many things. I got some Whit Stillman vibes, I got some Wes Anderson vibes, but I was really, really getting a Woody Allen vibe. Number one, the love triangle thing. You know, it's like, you know, more like a love, you know, insert shape, however many people end up in Woody Allen movies. And they walked around New York with piano music playing, talking about relationships. Sounds very Woody Allen-esque, doesn't it?
Yeah,
like the bad Woody Allen. So, here's the thing. That's all this movie is. Is people walking around New York with piano music playing while they bitch about relationships. That's all this movie is for an hour and 25 minutes.
Huh?
And there's a narrator. So, and the guy, the narrator, is a guy that's shown up in a couple of Wes Anderson movies. So it's clear they're trying to do this. Now, here's where they think they're being clever. There's a couple of things here. Obviously, the movie's extremely derivative. Like I said, between your, obviously trying to be Woody Allen and Stillman and Anderson, you also have, they're constantly referencing books. There's like a whole point about Pygmalion, and then there's this whole Jane Austen connection where they connect because she's reading Sense and Sensibility, or whatever the fuck that bullshit was. And it's just constantly referencing things. So, Bateman's character is writing a book. That's his goal through the whole movie. That's basically how he's going to try to make money, because he really, he's 35 and lived with his parents all that time that were extremely rich. The only way he can do anything is if he writes this book. And the big joke is the book comes out and they tell him that his work is entirely derivative of other things. So it's kind of like the movie thinks it's being clever by criticizing itself, but I don't know. And there's like a whole, you know, smugness to the whole thing. Where not just in the characters, but in the movie itself. So that's, you're basically getting it from two different places. There's this whole thing where they go to the theater and Jenny Slate goes on this tirade about pretensions, and it's kind of like you're wondering if maybe this is just her criticizing what they saw at the theater, or if this is the movie kind of being, thinking it's being clever by throwing a self-criticism at itself. But you can't really tell. Maybe that was just me hoping that's what they were doing, in hopes that they realized they were doing it at least. I don't know. One of the big problems is the Billy Crudup character. Once, like I said before, it's really hard to sympathize with him in this scenario because we don't really know. I mean, obviously, halfway through when it's revealed, you know, oh, by the way, I'm banging Olivia Wilde, sorry about that. His character throws a tantrum and kicks Bateman out. But the problem is that we never really knew, like, he threw, like, a couple of sentences out there about Olivia Wilde, and we never really saw them together, like, at all. It was all through his perspective of it. So, we don't really know, we're supposed to assume that what they had is, like, you know, was verging on something, and that's why he's so pissed off that she went with Bateman instead. But there's no possible way to know that because we spend no time seeing what their connection was. So when Crudup reacts that way, we as an audience really have no idea how to react to it. You know, maybe Crudup's like a Fatal Attraction type. We don't know. We know nothing about him. So that's a big issue. Being a movie that's all dialogue, it sucks that the movie's dialogue is extremely repetitive. There is like a couple of scenes where we see Bateman at his psychiatrist, and they have a whole monologue to the psychiatrist, and then in a later scene, he has that entire piece of dialogue, word for word, all over again, with Olivia Wilde's character. So obviously the movie was desperate. It's only an hour and 25 minutes. I don't think they had a full idea when they started writing.
Didn't sound like it.
So yes, there are scenes in this movie where there are two different scenes with basically the exact same dialogue. So take that for what you will. There's a point in time where Bateman tries to combat Jenny Slate's criticism by saying it's a satire. Does that mean the movie's a satire? Is it trying to be a satire? I kind of got the vibe that maybe it was trying to be a satire of something. I don't know what. You could just tell by the smugness of it. I think this is trying to say something about something, but I don't really know or care what it is.
That's a good thing.
Now, here's the problem. It's just really a matter of if you can put up with an hour and 25 minutes of people walking around New York doing aristocratic things. Like going to the theater, or to the opera, or to an instrumental performance, or whatever. That's all this movie is. montages of him and Olivia Wilde doing lovey things. Just over and over and over again.
Mm.
And the and another problem I really, really had is Olivia Wilde in this part. Because I've been talking all year with, like, Better Living Through Chemistry and Third Person. Olivia Wilde is, like, really starting to take off and really show the talent that she has. This is pretty much the worst possible time to take a part like this. Because this is not really a part. It is just... She's just basically this blank, attractive woman that's supposed to be there so these two guys have something to fight over. There is nothing to her whatsoever. Really, the only thing that's talked about with her is how she looks. Which, once again, may have been on purpose. Because, you know, social commentary or whatever. But, no, this movie was extremely hard to like. And normally, you know, Bateman is all about, you know, the selfish character. See Bad Words earlier this year, which is one of the best movies of the year right now, where all he did was play a selfish character, but it was brilliant, and there was a reason for it. And his character had many, you know, dimensions. Here, it just doesn't work at all. His character's just really, really grating, and you just want to sock the prick right in the face, and want them in hopes that credits roll over his unconscious body. Nice. So, yes, this movie was actually, like, practically torture. Like I said, at least it was short, but it's only short because they barely had anything to work with to begin with.
Yeah.
So that's a letdown given its cast.
Yeah. I think so.
Our last movie is a movie I didn't know much about until I watched it, which was actually a good way to watch it because what I'm about to tell you. It's called The Two Faces of January and stars Viggo Mortensen, Oscar Isaac, and Kirsten Dunst. It's, we opened and we're in Greece, and it's the 70s. It's worth noting a couple of things real quick about behind the camera. The Greece setting and just the aesthetic of the movie might look familiar. The author of the book that this is based on also wrote the, Tom Ripley books. So that's kind of, it kind of has that feel about it. It's kind of like the, not exactly a Minghella feel, but you can kind of tell it's like the, they kind of, it kind of has the same aesthetic as The Talented Mr. Ripley a little bit. And then we have, the adapter, technically, and director. The writer and director of this movie is the person that wrote Drive.
Interesting.
And another movie, but I'm drawing a blank on what it was. Shit. Anyway, yes, that's what you need to know, though, because you know how much I love Drive.
Yes.
The plot is Viggo Mortensen and Kirsten Dunst are this married couple who are in Greece, and they meet a tour guide who is Oscar Isaac, who is American, and he's just here, you know, hanging out. And his dad has died recently. So he's just kind of sitting around being melancholy. But when he sees Mortensen's character, he says that he is reminded of his father. So he kind of becomes drawn to Mortensen and basically follows them around. And he also kind of takes a liking to Dunst, obviously. Because she looks like Kirsten Dunst. That's enough to draw you to somebody.
Yes, it is.
So eventually, they basically, they kind of, you know, become friends and he gives them a tour and all that. But Kirsten Dunst leaves behind her bracelet. And he decides, well, I'll be the good guy and take it back to him. Well, as luck would have it, they get a knock on their hotel room door. And when he opens the door, it's not Oscar Isaac with the bracelet yet. It is a detective who is looking for him. And we learn, basically, that, Mortensen has been keeping secrets. I don't know if it's a spoiler to say what they are. Not really, because it doesn't really have anything to do with anything. It's just why he was being tracked by a detective. Basically, like, you know, stealing money and fraud and all that. So he's been getting tracked for a while now, and they've been found by this detective. And through a scuffle, Mortensen accidentally kills him. So he's dragging the body out of the room and taking him back. And when he's dragging this body down the hallway, there's Oscar Isaac there just to bring back this bracelet. So Isaac helps him out and basically gets involved in this. And he says that he knows a dude who can, like, you know, give them fake passports, and he can basically help them get out of here without getting caught. But the problem with this is when it gets really, interesting. Because we know both characters are kind of not to be trusted, because early in the movie, when we think Oscar Isaac's the con man, and Mortensen and Dunst are the innocents. There's this scene, there's a few scenes that hint at it, but the one scene that really stands out is, they're at, like, this stand, and Mortensen doesn't have the money to pay this guy, so he says, I need to basically trade in this country's money for this country's money. And Isaac says, well, okay, I can, you know, help you with that, just tell me, like, how much you're doing. And obviously, Isaac plays with the translation and ends up basically stealing about $1,000 from Mortensen in this exchange by telling him it's one thing when it's actually another. So at that point we know that maybe he's not like a bad guy, but he's not trustworthy.
Mm.
But now we've learned that it's Mortensen and Dunst who are the frauds who are hiding out under false names. So maybe they're the ones that aren't to be trusted. So we have two characters that aren't supposed to be trusted in this situation where they have to trust each other, or one of them is either going to die or one of them is going to get caught. And it's really interesting the way it plays out. It is a lot like a Hitchcock movie. Not just the feel, but like the setting, and even the title I thought sounded like the name of a Hitchcock movie.
Yeah.
And it's really interesting. After a while, the movie just turns into basically this game of wits between the two of them. Just me telling you that without any context. A movie that's a game of wits between Oscar Isaac and Viggo Mortensen.
That's fun.
And, yeah, and the movie does really pull it off well. Because it's also got that sense of underlying paranoia that both characters are kind of feeling from both sides. Because that whole thing is just looming over this movie of, there is nobody in this movie that can be trusted, basically. and you don't exactly know who's going to turn on who and when. And that's what I liked, is it's also, it goes in a couple of unpredictable directions. To the point where actually I had no idea how this movie was going to end after a while. Which is always a great thing, especially in a movie like this. Like, that's something that makes movies like this really sore. So, yeah, and I just love the whole old-fashioned feel of it. Like, not just the fact that it feels like a Hitchcock movie, but, like, you have plot points that center around, you know, fake passports and, like, what shows up in a newspaper. The only thing not in this movie is microfilm. I'm sure you could have done a whole plot point about that, I'm sure. But no, I mean, there are times where you kind of feel like it might be starting to lose its way, but it tends to find itself again. I think a lot of people might not like that, despite all this build-up and all the unpredictable directions it goes, the ending is a little anticlimactic, and maybe a bit underwhelming, but it never, like, totally shits the bed or anything. And it really, really helps with the... I mean, Dunst is good, but she doesn't have really a whole lot to do with this character. As basically, Olivia Wilde in The Longest Week, she's just kind of there to be the object that's between the two main characters. The great thing about... that really makes this movie work is the casting. This casting was perfect, because both Oscar Isaac and Viggo Mortensen have just this perfect way of being able to balance, you know, hey, I could be, like, a really good friend that's really trustworthy and will help you out, or I am totally and completely untrustworthy and I am so gonna fuck you over.
Yeah.
Both of them can believably do both of that, which made it perfect. So, Yes, I would recommend this if you like those little old-fashioned Hitchcock-style thrillers. It's more like Cary Grant Hitchcock, which I didn't like as much as, you know, like other Hitchcock thrillers, but it's in that vein, which is still fine, so. That's basically it for this one, I think.
Alright, as always, we're gonna run everything through, and you're gonna say yay or nay one last time. Leprechaun Origins.
No.
Life of Crime.
Yeah, sure.
Are You Here?
I wish I wasn't.
Jamie Marx is Dead.
If you want a really, really big laugh with some drunk friends, you will have a blast, I'm sure.
The Longest Week?
No, I don't know. There's nobody I'd recommend that movie to.
That's not good. And Two Faces of January.
Yeah, sure.
All right, so ends another edition of AJ's Movie Reviews. Next week, we're going to be talking about The Identical, as well as No Good Deed, Dolphin Tale 2, and three other films.
The Goyan movie. It goes under a couple of names. That was it. Can. It's either Captives or The Captive, depending on who you ask.
Okay.
And a couple of others.
Brady Versus coming this Sunday. Should be a fun one. And this Saturday, of course, Ashley will bring his Game with Ash segment. More Halloween Horror Nights content. Actually, you got that yesterday, and you're going to get it again next week. Mark my words. So, AJ, any parting words?
That's it.